latest in tech and accessibility. This is Access Tech Live with Stephen Scott and Marc Aflalo.
January is Braille Literacy Awareness Month, so we're getting ahead of things here at Access Tech Live. Grant Hardy is back with us. Grant, Marc, before we dive back into things, I just want to drop this clip in here because I spoke recently to CNIB's Andrea Voss to talk about basically how CNIB has been partnering with LEGO to distribute Braille Bricks.
CNIB and LEGO, we partnered in 2020 to help distribute the LEGO Braille Brick kits, the first philanthropic effort, the distribution of these kits to vision itinerant teachers across the country. Now, we've been successful doing so, and we've had a lot of people who maybe were not the desired user or intended user group for the Braille kits, because this is really for practitioners and for teachers who are responsible for teaching Braille to children. And because of the response, overwhelming response from people who were not teachers, maybe these were family members or people who had a neighbor or a friend who also wanted to access LEGO Braille Bricks. The LEGO group now has a retail version that is available, and it's available on their lego.com website for anyone who is interested in Braille and learning Braille in a fun way, inclusive way. Those are accessible to all now.
That is the CNIB's Andrea Voss. Now, Grant, have you had any hands-on experience with these LEGO Braille Bricks that I have to say, I can't wait to get my hands on?
Yeah, I have touched, I have had the opportunity to touch them at least. Really fantastic that they're now able to be purchased beyond schools and blindness organizations. I think that disabilities can be such a scary thing for people, especially a low incidence group like blindness, unfortunately. But something like Braille, people just think is so cool that it's a nice little entry into the world of like acceptance and inclusion. So fantastic.
Guys, I got to ask you both a question here, and correct me if I'm wrong, but when it comes to actually learning Braille, is this something that's actually being done actively when it comes to kids? I know, Stephen, you're taking Braille classes now. You're doing stuff at later in your life because it wasn't available to you when you were younger. Are we seeing a resurgence of Braille?
I would say we are. Yeah. Well, okay, Grant, you're the guest here. You go first, then I'll throw
in
my thoughts at the end.
No, I think absolutely Braille is taught in schools, especially for people who were born with vision loss. A little bit trickier if you lose your vision in later life, but I think Braille is pretty much an essential skill, unless your parent is really firm, I don't want this kid learning Braille or something. But otherwise, I don't think it's, you know, I don't think it's gone away or anything like that. Stephen, go ahead.
Yeah, well, it's funny you say that because I think the parenting part is actually a really important part of the discussion we don't often have, because the parents are making the decisions for us as children, right? Which is right and proper. But, you know, I do think there is more of a need, and maybe it's different in Canada, but certainly here in the UK for a long time, it has never been the case that children who are low vision, so who have some usable vision, were encouraged to learn Braille. What actually happened was they were encouraged to learn technology, which is good. And of course, we should encourage all children to know all about the latest technology. That's really important. But Braille is an essential skill, as you would agree, I'm sure, Grant, that, you know, it's such an essential skill. Not just, I mean, literacy, of course, is the key, but that leads to greater skills in education, greater ability to do more in education, and of course, give you the chance to do more and get a better job, get employed.
Well, absolutely. Braille is so heavily correlated with employment if you're blind. Plus, you have all these jobs that are now requiring STEM, you know, science, technology, math, which I would argue would be incredibly difficult, not impossible, to do with just speech. But Braille really adds an element of literacy, as you said, convenience, efficiency to your life. There are lots of tech options for Braille too. Like, it doesn't have to be low tech or anything. But absolutely. Like, if someone has the prospect of being blind or very low vision, I would say it's an essential skill to learn.
Grant, I was, you know, you know, full disclosure here, about a year ago, you did a segment for Double Tap TV, and I was super jealous because I was on the line with you, and, you know, you're facing the camera, you're doing what you're supposed to be doing, but you have the added bonus of being able to use your Brailler to read your script. So, you know, unlike me, who has to put a prompter up and figure out how I can make it look like I'm looking at a camera the entire time and focus on that and make sure that things are scrolling, you got all that front stuff in front of you. It got me really jealous. I'm curious, how long have you been reading Braille? Did you learn it at a young age?
I learned it as a very young kid, basically from, you know, kindergarten on. I was learning Braille as other people were learning print. And it's to say that it's an advantage in my life would be an understatement. I don't know where I would be without knowing Braille, especially like even in my job, moving into very fast paced, live shows, Braille has been very helpful for me. Not everybody knows Braille though, and they still do not only fine, but they do an exceptional job. So I certainly do not want to undersell what you can do without Braille. That's not what I'm saying at all. But it's definitely a huge advantage. I just the tech side, telling kids, I used to tell kids, like, I'm a guy that can read once they turn off the lights. I can read in the dark. And that used to make kids very, very jealous. Yeah, it's a neat thing to have in my back pocket.
You know, jumping back to the Braille Bricks, so, you know, I could see this as such a cool way for, you know, imagine just, you know, bridging a family, you know, just, you know, if you have people who are using Braille and people are not using Braille, being able to do something together that they would not necessarily have been able to do before is really, really cool. Being able to, you know, have that tactile, that feel to the bricks themselves. It blows my mind, guys.
I know, right? Absolutely. It's just all about that inclusion, making disability less scary, like more normalized, you know, having Braille in as many spots as possible so that the blind person can benefit from it, but also the public can like witness it, and it just seems more quote unquote normal. That's always the goal.
Yeah, and I think that's the key, isn't it? For children especially, and that, as I mentioned earlier with Matthews, is kind of how the whole LEGO Braille Bricks got started. It was about educating children who are blind to learn Braille, which of course is brilliant. But for adults as well, you know, we're not all doomed if we don't know Braille at
exactly
a young age, right? And actually, this is the thing. What I love in the last year is there seems to have been a change in the conversation about how we use Braille. So there's no expectation, I don't think, for anyone, including me at the age of 42 now, to be sitting here, being able to sit down on a Sunday evening and read War and Peace. As great as that would be, you know, that's unlikely to happen because the amount of time it would take me to read that book, aside the length of the book itself, wouldn't really be worth my time. But there are things we can do, right? We can use it for labeling. We can use it for quick notes, like you were saying, you know, just having access to information in front of you at your fingertips. That's where Braille can be useful to someone at an older age.
I know, exactly. And being able even to just start from a place of like, okay, you might not even know what the Braille means, but having a way to distinguish, to mark, to label something in a way that just feels kind of different from one label to the next, that's a great start. Or something like a tactile watch. Like, people think that tactile watches are for people who know Braille, but they're really not. They can benefit everybody, and it gives you a way, if you're wishing a bad date or a meeting away or whatever, you can check the time in a totally discreet way by looking at your tactile watch. So just all kinds of great things to get started, even if you don't want to or are not able to integrate Braille more into your life, or you don't think it's beneficial.
Lots, yeah, funny you say that. The amount of times we've all sat in meetings, in-person meetings, and we've all wanted to know the time but don't want to ask or don't want to look down. I want to ask you a bit quickly around technology, because technology, of course, has enabled, I think, Braille to survive in a way that perhaps it may not have done had it not been able to become Braille displays, you know, and get itself into that technology. Also now, for example, we see devices like the Habel 1, the Orbit Writer, coming out that are essentially small Braille-style keyboards that you can interact with your iPhone or your computer with. You know, is technology saving Braille?
Yes, I would say 100%. I can't even remember the last time I read on paper, like Braille paper. It's all about the technology. It's the Braille displays, the Braille note takers. I mean, the thing about them is they're still so much out of the reach for a lot of people because they're so expensive. They get outdated very quickly in terms of software and development and things like that. But absolutely, I think that it's bringing Braille like into the 21st century, and aside from the cost and the pain in getting something, it really adds a lot of accessibility to interacting with technology and Braille.
Well, gents, you know, we're going to be talking to a bunch of companies at CES in just under a month's time. And that tends to be when we find out about what the future holds when it comes to technology, including some of these Braille devices that you guys both use. Grant Hardy, thank you so much for taking the time to join us. We cannot wait to have you back on in the new year. Enjoy the holidays, and we will definitely speak to you soon.
Fantastic. Thank you.
Coming up on Access Tech Live, your answers to our question of the day. What is the most ultimate LEGO creation you have ever made? And we've got some photos. Do stick around. It is Access Tech Live.
We want to hear from you. Follow us on social media and get involved at Access Tech Live. We'll be right back.